The following program is sponsored by Friends of Life Outreach International.
The greatest commandment, loving God and loving each other. I tell them our goal is to become masters of love. And let me tell you, it's a challenge with all that testosterone and seven boys. Are you kidding me?
Loving God, loving each other.
Gospel Music Hall of Fame's Guy Penrod and his wife Angie, next on Life Today.
Thank y'all. I am excited. I'm holding here Guy Penrod's classics, and this is truly one of the most gifted people in every way, not only to sing. Boy, oh boy, can he do it. But we're going to talk about some things that I've seen in his life. I'm James Robinson, and this is my wife, Betty, and we welcome you to Life Today. Guy and his wife, Angie, is here, and they are just an absolutely beautiful couple. They have seven kids, right?
Seven boys and one girl.
And then pray to girl in.
Yeah, that's right.
Would you welcome Guy and Angie to Life Today? Seven boys. And did you keep pressing for the girl, or did he keep pressing for the girl?
That was me. That was me. I did it. I was begging in my prayer closet for the girl. Loving the boys, but praying for a girl.
Were those boys happy to see her?
Yes, they were.
I thought they would
They said they didn't need a girl, but they did.
How's she made it with all the boys? Is she okay?
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, she holds her own. She's pretty tough for an 11-year-old girl. Yeah.
Now, you played basketball, right?
I did.
You mind me asking how tall you are?
6'2½"
6'2½" And how tall are you, Guy?
Oh, roughly the same. About lip level. That's what drew me to her, you know.
Are the kids tall?
Oh, they are.
We're short at our house.
Our oldest is 6'7", our third born 6'6", and our 14-year-old is almost 6'6".
Wow.
And they're all just...
Are they athletes, too? Do they like sports?
They all love it. Oddly enough, they took to soccer, of all things.
What in the world?
I know. You know, growing up in West Texas and New Mexico, I had never heard of soccer. It's kind of like watching paint dry, really. But being tall, I thought they'd go to basketball, and their mom did, too. But
yeah. Well, I want to tell you, I'm thrilled to have you. I see God's glory all over you. I've told you that when we're just sitting together. I told you that when we were together at a major function in Washington, D.C. recently. You saw, after the inauguration, a rally where people were angry. I've never seen so many nasty words, heard so many nasty things. Did you walk in that and mingle? And what was your impression there?
We did, actually, the day after, you know, and the march was going on. And, you know, not to take away from anybody's right to disagree or to say it or to gather. That's not my... I felt a real spiritual oppression, like a heaviness. My heart hurt, literally. And I had undergone actually a heart procedure a couple of years back and had a stent put in. And I was having the same types of symptoms just walking around in those streets. And I mentioned it to you the day we were walking around because, like you said, there was such a... It's different. You know, I sin, I have sinned. And you have a self-evidence, a knowing when you transgress God's law, whether you're His child or not, there's always some sort of evidence in yourself. And that's one thing. But it felt like a celebration of behaviors that are not ambiguous in the Word. And we're told what the types of behaviors that we're trying to bring to the surface in our country, and we're told what it'll do to you. And it's out of love for us that God says, no, don't go down there. Don't go down there. That'll destroy you. Please, come here.
Yes.
You know? And it's out of that kind of compassion for us.
Absolutely.
That Jesus says, I paid for all of that. I did it. I took care of it. And you don't have to be in the bondage of it. You don't have to, you know, get lose the relationships, lose the peace that I purchased for you if you'll just come to me and do it my way. Mm-hmm. It's not a mean God doing this. It's a kind, loving God. But what we felt that day was so heavy, seeing mamas walk next to little girls and little boys that were holding signs that were filled with language you just would not use. And a sense of, I don't know, just anger after the inauguration. It was that following day. And I came home, in fact, and went straight. I went to my cardiologist, went to our pastors, first of all, and we prayed and prayed for the country. I loved what we heard at that event, you know. Christians pray. We tend to forget that, and if someone gets in office that we don't like, we don't pray for them because we don't like them. Or if they get in office and we do like them, we think, well, they've got it all figured out, and we don't pray. But the common denominator is the prayer. We need to pray for them. But at any rate, you're right. In that moment, we felt a deep sense of hope, actually, in the middle of kind of an odd, sure, you know, paradox because of all the anger around. I feel as though, and I said it that night, I think, we've been given a window where it appears that the leadership that's been elected will do some things that will make changes that may hurt in the short term, especially because we're in such a spending problem and we have such a debt issue, that they're going to be changing some of that, hopefully,
to
bring the debt into control. But the beauty of it is that it gives the church the opportunity at that point to be the church.
And meet needs.
And to meet needs. Exactly. Those, widows and orphans in distress. This is pure and undefiled religion. Mm-hmm. And helping those in need. And I think if we will, because all that a politician can do is tax, take, you know, in the form of tax, and then help or redistribute, even in its purest form, if there's no, corruption involved. If it's in its purest form, it's a finite source of resource, right? Only a certain amount of money to be doled back out. But our God is infinite. He has everything at His fingertips. And if we just are the funnels and we step out in faith and we say, okay.
Touch every need.
Exactly. And not that He has to give it to us first. He's saying, you know, Peter got out of the boat before he knew exactly what was going to happen. Mm-hmm. And then the Lord met him as in real time, you know?
Right.
And I just think the church is poised. It's standing as a rock in a crazy storm, that we can minister the truth and love of Christ as He fills us, and we just funnel it out to those around us.
You know, Angie, you said something to us that, boy, we feel so strongly about. Mothers, just give us your heart on the importance of being a mother.
Oh, I am just thrilled to be a mother of 8 children. And I thought about it earlier, and like to define motherhood, it is such an amazing, it's a pleasure to be able to connect these little humans to God. It's a whole, like, that's it. That's my whole life's goal, is take these precious gifts and in front of them live a life of the greatest commandment, loving God and loving each other. I tell them our goal is to become masters of love. And let me tell you, it's a challenge with all that testosterone and 7 boys. Are you kidding me? I am daily, you know, a referee / mom and everything
else.
Well,
it would make me sad when I would hear mothers almost apologize and say, oh, I'm just a mother.
No.
When that was my whole venture in life, you know, I wanted to be a wife, a good wife, and a mother.
That's right.
I felt like that was my calling from God, you know. Mm-hmm. And what an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
It's a big responsibility, but
yes,
it's also the biggest blessing you can ever ask for.
So
one of the cutest pictures and images we've got is our beautiful little daughter that's in heaven. And what a treasure. For her high school career day, she dressed up as a homemaker. When she got married, she said, I'm off now to do my career, and that's to be a mother, a homemaker, and a wife.
That is a blessing.
Don't you appreciate this beautiful couple? And what a treasure. And we're really praying, Guy, for God to... I'm really praying for Jesus' prayer to be answered. to where we really become one in a really supernatural way. And you're going to sing a song. What's the title of the song you're about to do for us?
Well, Loving God, Loving Each Other.
I think I know somebody said that's really important. That's like the summation of the whole of the Word of God. And in here is all the Word fulfilled. Paul said, when you just love your neighbor as yourself. In other words, really correctly. And would you like to hear Guy Penrod sing this great song? Do it for us, Guy.
Thank you.
Each other,
story never ends. No, the story never ends. No greater love hath a man than he lay down his life for his friend.
I can't even adequately describe how important that is in my heart. When I realize that's what Jesus prayed, because he gave us those commandments that sum it all up. But then he prayed that we would be one with the Father as he is. Now, that's a pretty special relationship.
Yeah.
That we could have that relationship he had with the Father. He's praying that far, so that means it's attainable.
Yes.
That means it's very important. And I really long for that, not just for me to have it, but for everybody to have it. And that in that relationship, miracles happen in every area that must be addressed by God through yielded vessels. Mm. But then he says that we can love one another. Mm. You know, it's like maybe that's bigger than loving the neighbor when you really love the family and you really love each other. And then that supernatural manifestation of love, then the world, everybody looking in, will know you're my followers.
Right.
You're my disciples.
Yeah.
And I really pray for that. And I ask all of you who are watching, let's pray we'll see that. Think about it. You want your prayers answered. And by the way, Isaiah 58 makes very clear what many passages do in the entire Bible, both Old Testament and New Testament. When you become an answer to prayer, your prayers are answered quickly.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing how involved God gets in our affairs when we're interested in sharing His heart with others. So I think that if we would say, God, we want our prayers answered, but how about we join with Jesus to see His prayer answered, that we have that relationship with the Father. This isn't religion. This is relationship.
That's right.
This is bigger than a marriage ceremony. This is marriage where you really have oneness through thick and thin challenges. So let's really pray for that. It's not only the longing of my heart, it's the longing of His heart. And I want to be a part of seeing His heart's dreams fulfilled. I believe you do too. Would you just say thanks again to Guy and to Angie for blessing us? Bless those eight kids. And all you boys, that sweet girl. God love you.